Well, here I am again. I thought I wouldn't be doing this again for a while, but Wendell came to me and said that he needed somebody to talk on this topic. Would I be interested? And he said, you shouldn't have a problem. You preached on it before. You could probably just redo that material. I couldn't remember having preached on it before, other than touching on it in a few peripheral areas. But I thought, well, by the way, it probably tells you how memorable my sermons are. I thought it's not going to be a problem because the last year I spent a lot of time on this particular topic, so therefore I had plenty of stuff to say. I always have plenty of stuff to say. The problem is how to narrow it down and put it into a 20, 30-minute exposition. But I didn't think there'd be any problem. And on the other hand, it's been one of the harder things to put together because getting a handle on how to do a little bit of it to fit that time frame is difficult. I had a number of ideas. Every time I sit down and begin working on the outline and filling it out, I discovered I was getting too technical for a Sunday morning, or it was too large a topic. You know, one of the ideas was to go through the various ways that the New Testament uses the Old Testament. And but you'd have to not only define the type of usage, but you'd also have to give illustrations and then explain those illustrations. And to do that with, you know, 12, 13, 14 different things would take forever. Better suited, I think, for classroom perhaps than Sunday morning. So I put together about 7 or 8 outlines. All of them fell apart when I tried to fit it into that parameter. So I had to sort of decide, you know, how much of each of the areas I can talk about on a Sunday morning this time. So you might find this a little choppy, sort of moving from aspect to aspect of this. On the good side, it probably means it's going to be a shorter sermon than some others. So you'll all enjoy that, I'm sure. Our starting point is to think about the Bible of Jesus and the apostles was the Old Testament. The Bible of the early church was the Old Testament. You know, imagine if you came here every week and the only thing we spoke on was the Old Testament. We have sort of done that somewhat this year with surveys of the Old Testament, but we're talking about every week. You know, you had the gospel, and you also had an increasing development of apostolic writings that you could read, but for the most part, everything they did in worship and instruction was related intimately with the Old Testament. We modern evangelicals are a little closer to being Marcionites. You know, we sort of, you remember Wendell talking about Marcion the earlier in this series. We tend to sort of skip over the Old Testament. You know, we may use it for stories and illustrations, and we teach character things on the individuals in Sunday school and that sort of thing, but we don't spend a lot of time in it. And indeed, of course, it's much, much older than the New Testament. The language is different. The cultural background of it is different. The customs and language is totally different. And we find it quite foreign. And being, you know, modern Americans, we don't like to put too much effort into it. You know, years ago I heard Ted preach a sermon where he started off by saying evangelicals believe that the Bible is a children's book. And that's sort of the way we approach it. You know, if we can't get a quick moral lesson out of it, or we don't have some, you know, positive promise that we can dwell on, we don't want to have to work to dig out what's being said. It's a strange way of thinking. It leaves us impoverished. You know, God has revealed himself beginning in the Old Testament and carrying on to the present. And, you know, it seems kind of insulting to say to God, well, you know, I'll take this part because I like that, but I don't want to have to deal with this other part because it's too much work, too much effort. I can't imagine actually telling God that in person, but, you know, that's sort of the attitude we have. It not only is important for God's revelation of himself, but it's also the foundation of everything else. And therefore, to inform yourself of it makes your understanding of the New Testament and the gospel much richer. C.H. Dodd once wrote, "The Old Testament forms the very substructure of New Testament theology." Absolutely the case. The foundation that undergirds it all is contained there. The more we can read and understand the Old Testament, and the more richly we can read and understand the New Testament. And overall, even beyond that, the goal, which is to better understand the God who has revealed himself in his scripture. When it comes to the New Testament use of the New Testament has somewhere around 300 direct quotes of the Old Testament and another several thousand allusions, phrases or aspects of it that are referred to in the New Testament. Recently, the most recent development in the last 30 years has been an additional category called echoes, which are just faint sort of recollections, phrases or words that cause you to think back to the Old Testament, which is a whole nother interesting topic. Numerous Old Testament writers argue their case, present whatever it is they're presenting with arguments from the Old Testament. If you're going to understand what those arguments actually mean and the force of them, you have to understand why he's referring to the Old Testament there. He's making his case on building blocks in the Old Testament. And so there's a lot to think about in this particular area. A good starting point in working with this category, how the New Testament uses the Old, is to understand the mindset of the New Testament writers who are using the Old. How are they using it? What are the foundational assumptions, the presuppositions that they're using for this? New Testament scholar Greg Beale has laid out five foundational presuppositions that these New Testament writers had. First, there's an apparent assumption of corporate solidarity or representation. That's something that's kind of foreign to us, but the idea that the nation of Israel can be represented by one person, and in the opposite way, the one person can represent, there's a corporate solidarity there, which we don't use usually in our modern times, and therefore becomes a presupposition we have to keep in mind when we're trying to understand what's the relationship here between the passage that the New Testament writer is writing about and this particular individual or this particular group. Beale's second presupposition, in light of corporate solidarity, Christ as the Messiah is viewed as the true Israel of the Old Testament and the true Israel, is viewed as the true Israel of the Old Testament and the true Israel of the church and the New Testament. So there's a relationship there that needs to be dealt with between what Christ does to Israel is what God does through Israel in some way is connected to what he does through the church. These aren't two separate things that have totally different playing fields. Number three, history is unified by a wise and sovereign plan so that earlier parts are designed to correspond and point to later parts. So that idea that the way God treated individuals in the Old Testament somehow reflects the consistency of God's character in his relationship with humans, his reaching out to humans and his redemption, those sorts of things are all consistently portrayed because we have a God who doesn't change. His character is crucial to the revelation in both the Old Testament and the New Testament. Number four, the age of eschatological fulfillment has come in Christ. So the capping off of history somehow begins, it's inaugurated in Christ. And that is the goal to which all history is headed. So things in the Old Testament are helping us see and expect this final eschatological consummation. And so there again is indications throughout the Old Testament that this is the central point. It's coming. The thing you need to look for is coming here. This will handle all the shortcomings of us as individuals in our relationship with God in the Old Testament and will answer all the longings and the perfections that we strive for in the Old Testament in Christ. And finally, five, as a consequence of the preceding presuppositions, it follows that the later parts of biblical history function as the broader context for interpreting earlier parts, because they all have the same divine author who inspires the various human authors. A deduction from this premise is that Christ is the goal towards which the Old Testament pointed and is the end-time center of redemptive history, which is the key to interpreting the earlier portions of the Old Testament and its promises. Again, that's important. If you look at the argument Paul makes in Romans, he's dealing with the issue of the expectations of Israel haven't been fulfilled, and they find themselves in exile. And the Gentiles are pouring in and receiving God's grace. What's happened to Israel? Did God fail? Did his plan fail? Did we misunderstand his relationship with Israel? And Paul in 9 through 11 deals with that issue. It's very crucial to understand that background in order to understand what Paul is saying. That's why that section has so many allusions and quotes from the Old Testament. He's making his case based on, look at this, 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 and this. It consistently fits in with what's going on in Christ. You really need that background material to do that. Otherwise, you're not going to understand part of what Paul says, and I think that's one of the reasons why there are so many different interpretations of that section in Romans is we fail to consider it. We think we know in that one little reference that Paul makes that that's it. But one of the interesting things in the study of the Old Testament use in the New Testament, and there was a time in the late 20th century when skeptics were saying, you know, the quotes that the New Testament has in the Old Testament doesn't appear to take any context of the original passage into account. They're just mining the Old Testament, looking for things they can sort of slap on and make it about the Messiah. And, of course, conservatives were, trying to answer that. The way that the liberals solved it was they said that early Christians didn't have copies of the Bible, the Old Testament, but they might have access to scrolls, and they would make up small manuscripts that would have quotes from the Old Testament pulled out of context, and then when they needed a quote, they would look at that and just pull one out and put it in there. And that's why they don't seem to have any sense of context of the original setting. C.H. Dodd, one of the great scholars of the time, through his study, managed to suggest that that's not the case, that in fact, if you begin looking at the quotes of the Old Testament and the New, it's clear that the context is being called by the quote. So, for example, when Jesus says on the cross, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? It's not just the suffering that he's referring to, but he's referring to that whole passage, that whole psalm, and to what it says. And if you don't understand that, you're not going to understand what Jesus said. We look at it and we think, oh, he's just using that as an expression because he's suffering so much. Well, that's true, but there's a reason why he's using that particular expression. And so Dodd says you have to look at it in context. And he's absolutely right. And that's one of the reasons why when you study something like Romans, you want to look at when Paul talks about this incident and he's using it to illustrate something, what is it that incident is about? What are the details to there? Does it match up with what my understanding of the passage is? Or is he trying to make another point? So it's important to do that. You're not going to understand it. You don't have a chance of understanding it if you don't understand how he's using those Old Testament passages. And that's not the only one. Just Romans is coming to mind because that's an obvious example. By the way, it's also interesting, this is a side note, that the idea of using scripture referring to previous scripture is not an innovation of the New Testament. The Old Testament does that. The Old Testament writers quote earlier Old Testament, or they allude to earlier things all the time. And we hardly ever think that. We always look at how does the New Testament use the Old, but we never look at how the Old Testament uses the Old. But it's that sense of consistency that somehow Revelation is under the hands of a sovereign God and history is going in a direction. And again, we miss the richness of that because we just treat it as sort of an isolated thing here by itself. It's also important to understand the variety of ways the New Testament uses the Old. It's not one-dimensional. There are a number, and sometimes passages may involve more than one type of usage in the same quote. One of my earlier outlines I did for today was to cover the 12 ways the New Testament uses the Old Testament as sort of delineated by Greg Beale, who, by the way, doesn't claim that that's an exhaustive list. But it soon became readily apparent that it would take a long time to do that because you can't do it without illustrations. And then the illustrations require defining and pointing out how it's being used, but you also have to do the background of those illustrations. So it's a much more complicated thing, and perhaps that's why we don't pursue those sorts of things in our personal study, as we probably should. Many of the varieties of usage are fairly straightforward. If you think, for example, of direct prophecy, it's pretty much what it sounds like. Somebody says, this is fulfills this particular thing, and he's pointing to a prophecy that predicts something specific, and it's fulfilled in a specific literal way in the New Testament. So for example, in Matthew 2, 5 through 6, when Herod asked the scribes and priests where the Messiah would be born, the answer is found in Micah 5, 2. But you, Bethlehem Ephrathah, though you are small among the clans of Judah, out of you will come for me one who will be ruler over Israel, whose origins are from old in ancient times. So there's no problem in understanding that. However, it might do you some good when you're studying to go back and look at that passage and look at the context of that passage. But it's pretty straightforward. You could actually understand that without any further work or referring back too much. Another straightforward use would be for moral example. So like Hebrews 11's listing of the Old Testament saints, or James recounting Abraham's believing God, or Rahab. I mean, it's not too hard to understand that. Again, we should remind ourselves of the original context, what the original story is. Because if Dodd is right, then as these New Testament writers are quoting the Old Testament, they expect it to bring to mind that whole incident, that whole account from the Old Testament, so that you can use that to enrich what he's saying. And that's subtly underneath what he's saying. It's expected to. So Jews listening to Jesus and seeing the cry, my God, why hast thou forsaken me, will immediately think to Psalm 22 and go into the details of that and understand that it ends with an acclamation of the future and the salvation brought by God. And so he's not going to end up in the grave. He actually is the crowning point of history that is being verged upon here. Another familiar use, which we sort of understand but isn't always clear, is as allegory. This is one which requires careful use. You know, in the medieval church, they took allegory. Once the gospel moved out into the Greco-Roman world, allegory ruled. That's how Greeks interpreted their writings, make allegorical presentations and arguments out of them. And so the early church after the apostolic time moved into that and went wild with allegory. The reformers, you may remember, did not care for that too much. Although they used allegory themselves, they tended to argue against its wider use within the church and tried to restrict it. And it's clear it's because you can do anything with an allegory. You know, the illustration I often use in my classes is, you know, did you know that Sleeping Beauty is an allegory of the gospel? Because Sleeping Beauty is, you know, approached by a witch who has an apple, and she takes a bite of the apple, and she goes into a death-like state of sleep, and the world grows around her, grows wild, weeds grow up, she's laying there, and everything's wilderness around her, and one day a prince comes, you know, the son of the king comes, and he gives her a gift of love. He gives her a kiss, and she wakes up, and everything's restored, and they live happily ever after. That sounds pretty good, actually. But the fact is, you can make allegories of almost anything, and that's where we get into trouble. If we're not careful, if there's no boundaries on how we use it, it could be problematic. Galatians 4, 21 through 31, I don't want to read it all, but it begins, "Tell me, you who desire to be under law, do you not listen to the law? For it is written that Abraham had two sons, one by a slave woman and one by a free woman. But the son of the slave was born according to the flesh, and the son of the free woman was born through promise. Now this may be interpreted allegorically. These women are two covenants. One is from Mount Sinai, bearing children for slavery. She is Hagar. Now Hagar is Mount Sinai in Arabia. She corresponds to the present Jerusalem, for she is in slavery with her children. But the Jerusalem above is free, and she is our mother." So there you have Paul defining that he's using an allegorical interpretation here. So you find it rare in the New Testament, but there are examples of allegorical interpretation. But it's carefully applied, and you have some warning about it. Perhaps the one use most misused is indirect prophecy, what's also known as typology. In typology, you have an object or a person or whatever who foreshadows something in the future, which is fulfilled in that second occurrence of it. So you have the type, and then you have its fulfillment in the antitype. And it's used quite frequently in the scriptures. And again, you've got to be careful about understanding what that is and avoiding misuse of it or seeing misuses of it where they occur. So the study of analogical correspondence, this is a definition of it. Allegorical correspondence, that means, of course, what we're talking about, the comparison of two things and how they correspond together, not the differences, but how they correspond together. So this is a formal definition that, for the most part, is pretty well accepted as a formal definition of typology in evangelical circles. This has some language in it that isn't the easiest to understand, so I'll read it, and I'll come back and highlight the major aspects of it. So here's the definition. Typology is the study of analogical correspondence among revealed truths about persons, events, institutions, and other things within the historical framework of God's special revelation, which from a retrospective view are of a prophetic nature and are escalated in their meaning. Is that all clear? Who wants to repeat it back to me now? It's quite awkward, but it's important when we define it that all those aspects are present there. Otherwise, you have a faulty definition. Let me read it one more time, then I'll talk about each aspect of it. The study of analogical correspondences among revealed truths about persons, events, institutions, and other things within the historical framework of God's special revelation, which from a retrospective view are of a prophetic nature and are escalated in their meaning. Okay. The first aspect of that is analogical correspondence. That, as we said, is just simply how the two relate. How they're alike, not how they're different, but how they're alike. Secondly, historicity. This is important because it's not talking about typology involving spiritual truths. It's talking about something historical, something physical, something tangible that's then related to something else. So people oftentimes try and make typological things out of spiritual truths in Scripture. That's not what it is. Three, a pointing forwardness or an aspect of foreshadowing or pre-significance. In other words, it isn't meant to be taken just as an incident off by itself. It has a foreshadowing of something to come. This may be explicit, it may be implicit, and so it could be either way. And by escalation, we mean that it adds something, the antitype adds something to the original. There's something that pushes beyond that. So the antitype is in some ways heightened or, you know, pushed forward in the New Testament correspondence in relationship to the original type. So, for example, John 19:36 views the requirements of not breaking the bones of the Passover lamb in the Old Testament epic to point to a greater greater reality of the bones of Jesus not be broken in his crucifixion. And when you look at that in there, it's actually has a phrase in there that scripture may be fulfilled. So the idea is that fills up the meaning of the original by looking at its ultimate. And then finally, when it talks about retrospection, what it means is that after Christ's resurrection and under direction of the Spirit, the apostle writers understood certain Old Testament narratives about persons, events, or institutions to be indirect prophecies of Christ or the church. So all those elements define the typologic, the definition of typology as it's used in the New Testament. Well, the word typos is Greek, and of course, Greek's used in all sorts of different ways, but specifically, this is how the writers in the New Testament use it. Lost my place. An example of typology is John 13:18. I'm not speaking of all of you. I know whom I have chosen, but the scripture will be fulfilled. He who ate my bread has lifted his heel against me. This is in the Lord's Supper when Jesus is leading up to the betrayal of Judas. But it's a quote from Psalm 41:9, which part of it says, even my close friend in whom I trusted, who ate my bread, has lifted his heel against me. But you, O Lord, be gracious to me and raise me up that I may repay him. That sounds a little ominous there, doesn't it? But you can see the betrayal, the setting for Psalms is not contained in the Psalms itself, but it is generally in tradition about the Psalm, is that this is David talking about the betrayal of his closest counselor at the time who joined forces with his enemies against him. And that's what's going on in the Lord's Supper. And that sort of foreshadows the event of the Lord's Supper and the betrayal of Judas. So there are plenty of examples legitimately of typology in New Testament, but sometimes preachers, gotta love them, often search the Bible and surprisingly find typology everywhere, even if it's not there. Here's an example, it goes back some years, it's a famous radio preacher. He's going to remain nameless this morning, but he had a regular show. This isn't, you know, a quack televangelist that we might see today. This guy was a respected preacher and had a regular radio show that was listened to all over the country. You'd probably those of you who are old enough would probably recognize the name, but we're not going to go there. Here's from his treatment, part of his treatment of the creation of Eve from Adam's side in Genesis 2. So remember the details of that in the New Testament or in the Old Testament. Here's his typological treatment of it. While Adam slept, God created from his wounded side a wife who was part of himself, and he paid for her by the shedding of his blood. Now all is clear. Adam is a picture of the Lord Jesus, who left his father's house to gain his bride at the price of his own life. Jesus, the last Adam, like the first, must be put to sleep to purchase his bride, the church. And Jesus died on a cross and slept in the tomb for 3 days and three nights. His side, too, was opened after he had fallen asleep, and from that wounded side, redemption flowed. I'm sure you saw that when you read that passage in Genesis. I should have probably done it in his voice and his intonation, but yes. I'm incapable of that. Wendell could do it. No.
We'll send that for New Year's Eve.
All right. Elsewhere, another preacher roughly the same time, this one was even considered somewhat of a scholar, takes a passage from Exodus 27:19, which just talks about packing things for the tabernacle up as they getting ready to go in the next thing. And it basically talks about not forgetting to put the brass tent pegs. And so it's not really a very significant passage. Just remember to put these things in the luggage when you pack up. And of course, because he's, you know, a good evangelical at the time, he needed to use the King James Version, which translates as pins rather than pegs. So not a big deal, but it helps him a little bit with his argument. And so his treatment of it is the pins or nails, the tent pegs, of the tabernacle were made of brass. Therefore, they did not rust. As they withstood every desert storm, even so Christ's holy life withstood every onslaught of Satan. How minutely the details of the God-given pattern for the tabernacle in the wilderness foreshadow the glories of our own crucified and risen Lord. Okay, that's a bit of a stretch. But the previous pastor I talked about, the radio pastor, not only agreed with that, but he also added, we repeat, the pins were buried in the ground and also emerged from the ground. And so to speak, it speaks of the death and resurrection, that which is buried and that which is above the ground. The part of the pins beneath the ground become a symbol of the death of the Lord Jesus Christ. The part above the ground suggests his resurrection. And this is the gospel, the good news of salvation, the finished work that makes us secure. If the pins were driven all the way into the ground, they would be worthless. Part of them must be above the ground in order that the ropes may be attached to them. So too, the death of the Lord Jesus Christ by itself could not save a single sinner. The good news of the gospel is not only the cross, not only the death of Christ for sinners, but it is the death plus the resurrection of our Savior. The pins are buried, but also rise above the ground in order to make us secure. Again, that sort of thing is a little too often in I used examples that were somewhat dated because it's safer that way. You know, I've had the misfortune a few times in my life of preaching on hermeneutics and how contemporary writers and pastors preach a passage totally misrepresenting it. And afterwards, after teaching the class, I'd be in the service afterwards and the pastor would be preaching, and suddenly I'd have 20, 30 people turn around and look at me because the pastor was using one of the examples I used in class. So I have one other quote that includes some of that, and it may be that one of these in here has been used by you if you've taught at all. I've not heard anybody in here do it. I'm not zeroing in on anybody or pointing anybody out, but I wanted to warn you ahead of time in case you have used it. This is from a quote dealing with the possible examples of this sort of thing, and frankly, it's a little scary. The example before was scary enough, actually, but not all examples are as wild, and there's a few mentioned in here that aren't nearly so wild-eyed and have been used. This is from David L. Baker, who's a pretty interesting writer on the use of the Old Testament in the New. And here's what he says, quote, sometimes the word typology has been used for what is really symbolism or allegory, but the most common failing is to find correspondence in trivial details. There was no historical or theological correspondence between Rahab's scarlet cord and the death of Christ, nor between the axe Elijah retrieved from the river and the cross. There is a consistency in God's created order which makes it possible for there to be red or wooden objects in both Old and New Testaments, but that does not mean that these things have any typical or exemplary importance for the Christian. He uses those two examples, by the way, not from modern usage, although those things I still hear used once in a while, but actually they come from the early church. The first one, the Rahab and the scarlet cord, comes from First Clement, and the axe is an argument used by Justin Martyr. So these things have been around a long time. It's not a new invention. There's a consistency in God's created order which makes it possible for there to be red or wooden objects in both the Old and New Testament, but that does not mean these things have any typical or exemplary importance for the Christian. Nevertheless, the fact that the term typology has been applied to trivial correspondence confused with allegory and symbolism and misused in the exegesis of the Old Testament does not invalidate it as a principle if properly used. And although we should certainly not adopt such exegetical methods, neither should we despise those who use them. It was the allegorical school of the early church who preserved the Old Testament for the Christian church. There's a Christian view. You know, I'm criticizing, but don't, you know, don't turn your back on these people. Those people had an important thing. They preserved the Bible we now have. So, you know, everybody's not bad because they do something that may not be correct. Grant Osborne, the great New Testament scholar who died in recent years, listed a number of guidelines or suggestions to help sort of protect us from going wild on the typological comparisons. And he wrote them primarily for ministers or teachers, but it, I think, is something you could use as you do your personal study too, assuming that you want to get into this sort of thing and dig into it a little bit. We usually don't because it's, you know, we have time constraints on our life. Number one, make certain that the relationship between type and the antitype centers on historical correspondence rather than spiritual concepts. We already talked about that. You know, don't try and take a spiritual concept and do typology with it. It's meant to take something historical, concrete, real, and match it up with something else. Two, study areas both of correspondence and the differences between the two so as to determine the exact areas of parallel. So, you know, you want to look at how is this alike and how is it also different, because you don't want to push the typology to cover everything in it. You want to see what's the specific point he's trying to make and how does that fit in with the original. Three, avoid establishing doctrine on the basis of typology, which is normally used in Scripture to illustrate rather than to establish dogma. So don't use this as the defense or reason for a particular theological concept. You could use it as illustration of it, but don't use it to develop it. Number four, do not seek types where the context does not allow them. Subjective use leads to allegorizing and is dangerous. We don't hear dangerous on the Bible study stuff enough. There are dangers in Bible study. That's why you've got to be alert and careful and discerning. That's what discernment's about, being able to distinguish between the good and the bad. And finally, allow the richness of the type to speak anew both of the essential unity of Scripture and of the faithfulness of God to his people in every generation. We're not just looking for information when we do this. We're looking for information so that we can better understand the God who we claim to worship. Again, a good reminder that we're not just out gathering knowledge, but that we really are looking for something that tells us about God and who he is and what he's done. And all of those things are good ground rules for analyzing typology, or at least keeping yourself restricted from going off on flights of fancy when it comes to that. There's no way to sum up everything I said, because I picked from this and that, and I sort of hit various topics. But I would say the important thing, as we consider the subject, is to remind ourselves how impoverished our understanding of the Old Testament often is. And if I could say one thing to you today, I would say, let's not be Martianites when it comes to the Old Testament.